Hi everybody, my name is Niccolo Maurizi. I'm a cardiologist with a special interest for cardiomyopathies working in Lausanne University Hospital in Switzerland, and I'd like to welcome you to the sixth episode of HCM Pills. I'm here in Amsterdam with Harald Jorstad, a cardiologist with a special interest in sports cardiology and expert in the field. We'd like to discuss today about sports in HCM and I'd like to remember you that this series of webcasts is sponsored by the HCM Patient Foundation, an organization, a non-profit organization for all the patients with HCM in Europe to provide reliable information about this disease. So let's go to the heart of the problem. The first question, what are the benefits of sports in general and do they apply to HCM patients as well?
First of all, Niccolo, thank you so much for having me here and for having the opportunity to talk about something I'm really passionate about, namely sports cardiology and what the opportunities and possibilities are when it comes to the heart. And I think we should be very clear about something. Everybody should be engaging in some sort of sports. It can be vastly different. It can be at your own level, at different intensities, but the benefits of sports are huge. We know that sports is beneficial for most parts of the heart, but it's beneficial for the rest of your body as well, for your muscles, for your bones, for your brains, for your kidneys, for all your arteries. So I think the message should be very clear when it comes to that. Sports is great. If we could prescribe it as a pill, we would all be taking it.
I couldn't most agree with your point. So, but there is a problem because, you know, most of our patients in our clinic, when they get a diagnosis of a cardiomyopathy, they really are afraid in engaging sports. So how you guide them? How really do you suggest them? And what should we do and what should not be do? And are there tips and tricks that really you use for that?
I think with hypertrophic cardiomyopathies, it's quite challenging because we have a history of a lot of fear and anxiety when it comes to sports and what it does to your heart when you have a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Back in the 80s and the 90s, we thought that sports could really lead to severe arrhythmias associated with sudden cardiac arrest and death. But the newer studies are showing that actually we might have overestimated that risk. And of course, we have so many new imaging modalities, ways to exercise test, ways to risk stratify, and ways to prevent severe events from happening. So I think we're moving towards a more liberal time period where we're not so much looking at what is impossible, but what is possible. And that's where the real challenge lies, because every heart of a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathies is different. Some have problems or the thickening in one place, some don't feel anything, some have conduction problems, arrhythmias. So for each patient, I think we can't say there's one size fits all. You need to really understand the heart and the motivations and objectives of someone. And that's where you start putting together your sports advice for each individual patient.
So this really brings me to my next question. So, I mean, I believe nowadays there is a central role for the sports cardiologist in the management of a patient with HCM. So really, in a typical consultation, what would you tackle with your patient? Would you share common objective? I mean, would you really give advice based on the type of the heart condition they have, whether the heart is more hypertrophied and there is a more obstruction, or whether... So how do you really tailor the need of each patient and what do you tell them at the end of the day in your consultation?
Niccolo, I'm so happy you're asking this question because I think every patient, regardless of their cardiac disease, deserves the sports advice before they leave the room after the consultation, and especially so for hypertrophic cardiomyopathies. I think what we need to start with isn't so much the heart, but who's the owner of the heart?
Yeah.
What are your objectives? Why do you want to engage in sports? Is it because you want to look good at the beach? Is it because you want to run a marathon? Is it just because you want to remain healthy? Or is it because you want to join your mates and play football? Those are all different motivations and require a different approach. And then you delve into the details of the heart. Where is the thickened segment? How does the ECG look like? Does it respond well to exercise? Is there obstruction? There are so many different parts of this disease because this is a disease that can encompass basically every level and every function of the heart. So you need to look at where could there be challenges, where could there be risks. But that there are risks doesn't mean you can't do something. You need to look at how can we mitigate that risk. So do someone have symptoms, for example? We should try to avoid that or treat them so they don't have symptoms. Do we see that the heart reacts adversely to some levels of exercise? Well, then maybe try to make an exercise regime that doesn't include that kind of exercise. But always align it with the motivations and the wishes of the patient themselves, because if I tell you you should be running and all you want to do is to build muscles in the gym, well, then we're not aligning at all and nobody will be happy from a consultation like that. So I think it's really the holistic picture. What are your objectives? Does your heart allow it? What does your heart allow? And then sometimes you need a lot of extra diagnostics to understand what's going on. But when you decide on what you're going to do, that's just the beginning, because then you need to try, you need to see what happens, you need to evaluate, sometimes to monitor extra, Holter monitoring or wearable devices, for example, and then see, are we getting where we want to be? Are there any other problems? And if it works out, well, fantastic. And if it doesn't, revise, make a new plan and continue.
Great. I mean, I couldn't agree more on what you said. So we're really moving to a sort of a mindset where we should prescribe really sports to our patients. So it's not more beta blocker, myosin inhibitors, but there is also part of, you know, sports prescription. This is a very important concept that has to be taken by all of us. So let's go to, you know, a tough ground. Historically, you know, sports, HCM, If you Google that, you ended up seeing sudden cardiac death. How rare is sudden cardiac death in sports and sports with cardiomyopathies nowadays?
Fortunately, it's very rare, but it does happen. And we know from recent studies from Europe that, well, sports can be, exercise can be a trigger for sudden cardiac arrest in general. And even though if you look at the nationwide study, it's mainly from coronary artery disease, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is still an important disease that can cause a sudden cardiac arrest and death. However, it's very rare. And these days we are screening and we are preventing a lot of it and we are treating it proactively. And of course, we're entering a new era now with the myosin inhibitors. But I think it's important to know that no, the risks aren't zero, but I think there are some fantastic studies from Italy that show that elite athletes that were disqualified from participating in elite level sports, half of them decided to continue anyway. And when looking back almost 20 years later, we did not see a big difference in outcomes in the athletes that stopped and the athletes that continued. So we might have given sports and exercise a little bit of a too bad reputation. And as I said, I think that has generated a lot of fear, the earlier studies. I think we're now entering more the era where we have more confidence in giving a sports advice, sticking to it and monitoring it. So risks will never be zero, but they're certainly not prohibitive.
Very important message, thank you. So you just mentioned before a wearable device. We have a sort of a technological revolution on our daily life. And, you know, we do have many wearables out there in the market. Do you find some to be more important for you as a physician? And how do patients might relate to them? Are they useful? How should they use? What do you do in your clinical practice?
I think it's important to realize that devices are just tools. And they will give you a lot of data based on algorithms, and sometimes they will make it up. So first of all, as a caregiver and as a patient, know what you're doing, because the device, it's just a device. It won't think for you. And second of all, know what the device actually does, because devices measure different things. And some of the things they will actually measure and some of the things they will just compute and give you a fictitious answer based on algorithms. Most devices don't make an ECG. They make PPG, so photoplethysmography, which is basically just looking at the skin. And while they can very correctly assess heartbeats, they can't actually see if there's an arrhythmia and what kind of arrhythmia there is. So I think for us as doctors, the first step is know what your devices are doing, know what they can tell you, but also be honest about what they can't tell you. And second of all, get experience with it, both as a patient and as a caregiver, so you're comfortable with getting these readings and you can have them in your infrastructure. Because if you're going to look at tracings all day long from 100 devices, from 100 patients, you won't have time for anything else. So know the devices, know what their weaknesses are, know what their strengths are, and they're only tools. They won't give a guarantee for anything. And basically, you can mainly use them to maybe hone in on symptoms or to know what you're actually doing, in which zones you're training, what you're actually doing. Should you maybe do more intervals? Can you trace that with your device? Or should you be doing more endurance training, for example? Then a device will help you a lot. But my final comment would be, they are limited and know the limitations.
Wow, that's very nice. So thank you very much. I mean, I think it's been a very important webcast, very important messages for us physicians, for patients, and we are really moving towards a mentality where sports is part of, should be part of the life of everybody, but specifically of HCM patient, has the power to be a medication and also act as a pill. So I really thank you very much for being today with us. Thank you for watching this video, and I encourage you to comment and to post a different question you have. We might answer to you, and we might do other webcasts on the most common question you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And remember to subscribe to our channels, to our YouTube channels, to have more videos, more experts, and more insight into this disease.